Well, it's truly a delight to be here. I want to pose a very simple but provocative question. You are sitting there. I am standing here. We are experiencing a three-dimensional space, length, width, and height. We also have on our watches, so there's another dimension, time. And so we are here in a four-dimensional world. I would like to ask a very simple question. Can there be a fifth dimension? And this extra dimension would not just be a dimension, say, of time, but we're thinking a dimension of space. But isn't that a weird question? Can you imagine moving in a direction beyond length, width, and height? And so that is a provocative question of today's story. Let us begin by taking a look at a little bit of issues that would relate to a higher dimensional object. So let us begin with the following picture. We have a wire cube, and we're going to shine light on it. What you're seeing below is a shadow of that wire cube. But it's not just an ordinary shadow. It's a special one that captures the extra properties of the full object. So if you count the vertices in this cube, you'll see the number of vertices in that shadow. If you count the edges in that cube, you will see the exact number. In fact, this shadow has a name. It's called a Schlegel diagram. Now, the question arises, what would be the shadow of a four-dimensional cube, a tesseract that we're all familiar with? In that case, the shadow will not appear in the ground. It would sit in three-dimensional space. And that shadow would look something like this. Some of you have seen this picture. It's a diagram that also captures the higher dimensional properties of this four-dimensional cube. Again, you can count the vertices, the edges, the faces, and so on. Well, this is a picture that has captured the ideas of architects, artists, and so on. If next time you're in Paris, you should take a look at the Grand Arch. You will see that this was the winning entry by the architect Spreckelsen for the competition of the Grand Arch set out by Mitterrand. It is actually a five-dimensional representation of this object that can sit in a five-dimensional space. So this is the kind of thing that we would like to address from a physics point of view. And in order to do that, let us begin by taking a look at Einstein's theory of gravity. When you look at how gravity acts on light, there is something very peculiar that happens. We all grew up thinking that light follows a straight line. But one of the profound things that Einstein showed us is when you have light traveling in space, the gravity of objects will bend it. And he was the first person to give the correct calculation of the bending angle. Now, I'd like to share with you an essay that he wrote in 1936 that most people are not aware of. In this essay, in fact, he was 57 years old, he showed that if you have an object, so in this case, you have a satellite, and here we are on Earth. Notice when the signal travels to Earth, it's bent by the gravitational field of the sun. But let us imagine now you have a star. He looked more closely at that bending and discovered that you would see double images of this background source of light. You would have a cosmic mirage. In the same essay, which was just a page and a half, he also observed that if the source of light sits on the line of sight, so here we have the source on the line of sight, and here it is off the line of sight. When it's off the line of sight, you see two images. When it's on the line of sight, it appears formally very bright, and so bright, it looks like a ring. I would like to take that essay and reinterpret it. This is what is going on. There is actually a shadow pattern being created at the location of the source. And this shadow pattern is actually being generated by the action of gravity on light. In other words, objects in the universe cast shadows throughout the cosmos. And these shadows, they're different from these Schlegel diagrams that I showed you earlier. These are natural things in the universe. And so in this case, here in the background, I'm just showing you the pattern created by a star. So if you cut across here, your brightness will do this, it will go to a peak and then drop. What does the shadow pattern look like, say, due to 30 stars? Here is an image that was generated from complete analysis of the equations that come from Einstein's theory of gravity. So if you look at this, it may remind you of when you look at light glittering on the side of a boat when you're in a harbor. But these are produced in the universe. If you have 100,000 stars, this is what it would look like. It's getting more and more complex. We know that stars have planets. If you include the planets, the shadows will begin to pick up microstructures. And this is an example of what it would look like. Doesn't that remind you of the neural network of a brain, as we had from an earlier speaker? It's just amazing the profound similarities that appear in science. Now, this is the basic idea that will sit inside the question of higher dimensions. Well, the basic question sits with the theory of Braneworld gravity. In this world, you have length, width, height, time, and then there's an extra one that we'll call the fifth dimension. The shadow patterns you just saw, that comes from Einstein's theory. And in that theory, we're in a four-dimensional universe. The question is, what happens with the shadow patterns in a five-dimensional world? And would that help us to address the question of knowing scientifically that there is an extra dimension to physical space? So here is Braneworld gravity in a nutshell. The word brain, B-R-A-N-E, is a shorthand for membrane. And I'm going to briefly show you a picture that's the Randall-Sundrum formulation of that theory. And what it says is that our universe sits in this five-dimensional world. Here I represented our universe by this flat sheet. So this flat sheet is actually a four-dimensional entity. And you can have another brain, a parallel universe to ours. And so then this direction would represent the direction of the fifth dimension. And so as we stand here or sit here, you're experiencing physical space in our universe. So we are locked on here. But then how would we know there is something off that? That is the question. And the key is to take a look at this issue of how gravity acts on light. I'll share with you some research done by the astronomer Charles Keaton and myself by taking a gravitational lensing approach to trying to figure out, and we know there is a fifth dimension. And the story begins with the Big Bang. Early in the universe, temperatures were extremely hot. The universe was extremely dense. And these densities were uneven. The areas that were more dense actually collapsed and created black holes. And in this environment, you have these microscopic black holes being formed. In particular, if the universe is five-dimensional, you would have five-dimensional Braneworld black holes being formed. If the universe is four-dimensional, you will have microscopic regular black holes you know about from Einstein's theory being formed. And so the question is, how could we tell the difference between the two? The strategy is to try and find a Braneworld black hole by looking for its signature, its fingerprint on light. And we approach this problem by using a very simple law about the behavior of these objects from the early universe to now. And it has to do with the following issue. Imagine you have a black hole that's probably the size of a nucleus, but the mass of an asteroid. So this is a very powerful object. When such objects were formed in the early universe, in Einstein's theory, they would have fizzled out by today. And that is because they're very hot and they radiate energy according to a certain law. And that law is governed by the four-dimensional properties of Einstein's theory. If, however, that microscopic black hole is five-dimensional, if it's formed in the context of Braneworld theory, it would be cooler and therefore would not fizzle out to today if it has a mass of that of an asteroid or less. And so the idea is that today, such objects from a Braneworld point of view would exist. And now we want to find how they will act on light. The basic idea is this. Imagine you have a still pond and you drop a pebble. It is going to create ripples. And those ripples are actually going to give you the key signature, the key fingerprint of these black holes. The same way how you have in this pattern the waves that are going out. You have the lows and the highs, and then it dies off towards the end. The Braneworld black holes will do a similar thing. And here's a cartoon of what its signature and light will look like. It is different from the signature and light that a star would create than the one in Einstein's essay. Because here, the Braneworld black hole is microscopic. But it has a lot of mass. It can have a very powerful gravitational field. And so when you look at this pattern in the background, you can actually predict the signature it's going to have. And this is what it looks like. It's going to do the following. Just as in the wave, you'll see it wiggles like that. And if there's no Braneworld black hole, you're going to have a constant signal that cuts across in this way. And so what we did is to take the question of an extra dimension into one of searching for an object from that extra dimension, namely a microscopic Braneworld black hole. And we are able to fingerprint it by its action on light. This prediction is actually accessible to current technology. We have a satellite in orbit right now, the Fermi Space Telescope, and this can measure energies in a very high range, in what's called the 200 MeV range. And it's exactly in that range that we are predicting this wiggle ought to exist. And so the story really is saying the following. If we find evidence for this wiggle, it is going to favor this five-dimensional point of view of the universe. And imagine there was a point when we thought the universe had certain properties, beginning with Earth. In the old days, remember, the universe was really the Earth and the stars, and you thought the Earth is flat. And then there was this provocative idea that it's round. I believe that we are at a similar stage where if you find evidence for a fifth dimension, you are going to now have an entire paradigm shift of our understanding of reality. Thank you.